اللهم افتح لنا أبواب حكمتك وانشر علينا خزائن علمك. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا، إنك على كل شيء قدير. My dear brothers and sisters, I salute you all with the salutation of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is indeed a pleasure. It is an honor for us to gather tonight once more to discuss one of the most important topics, a topic that is so dear to everyone's hearts, and that is talking about youth, talking about teenagers. It is a stage that every single person of us did go through that phase, and yet we tend to have a short memory, and only when we are blessed with kids and they go through that stage, we realize how difficult it was and how difficult it is. And sometimes we wonder, did you truly ask for it? Because when people get married, they always desire to have kids. And they think of children as loving, cuddly toys that they can have and play with and have fun with, only to realize the more they grow, the more demanding they become. The more they grow, the higher the maintenance they become. The more they grow, the more attention they need. The more they grow, the more troublesome they become. And one begins to wonder, was it a good thing to have children in the first place? Or would it have been a better idea not to have them? Nevertheless, one has to see having children as a blessing, has to see it as a gift. For Almighty Allah mentions that it is a gift that He gives, He bestows upon those whom He favors. يَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَاثًا وَيَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ الذُّكُورُ. Allah gifts those whom He wills, girls, and those whom He wills, boys. أَوْ يُزَوِّجُهُمْ ذُكْرَانًا وَإِنَاثًا. Or He gives them both boys and girls. وَيَجَعْلُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ عَقِيمًا. And Allah makes some barren, unable to bear children, as part of His wisdom. With that in mind, today we're going to talk about this very crucial stage. By the show of hand, can I see how many of you have teenagers as children? Please raise your hands. Very few. How many of you as men are between the age of 40 to the age of 50? Please raise your hands. Okay, and you are going through a second phase of teenage. How many of you are below the age of 9? Below the age of 9. We have 1, 2, 3, below the age of 9. Below the age of 9. We have a few people, okay? Below the age of 9. No, you. You as a person below the age of 9. Do you have anybody below the age of 9? Nobody. No, first phase. Nobody. Okay. So in that case, you've all embarked upon that stage, that phase, once upon a time, or you are going through that phase for the first time, or maybe through the second time, or you have children, or you're expecting children to go through that phase, or you have brothers and sisters, or you have relatives who are going through that stage, or you know a friend or someone who seems to be complaining or having difficulties managing their children or teenagers, whether boys or girls. So tonight, we are gathering here to try to understand. Once we understand, then we can begin to think how best to make that phase the most enjoyable part rather than the most torturous, treacherous times that we go through. The first thing that I would like to hear from you, yeah, and I would like, I don't know whether you have mics to go around, but whatever you say, I will echo back. I would like to understand, what are the typical issues, what are the typical challenges you have with regard to teenagers? So just shout. Stand up. Sorry? The surrounding environment. The surrounding environment, you want to raise them one way, and the surrounding environment wants to raise them another way. Okay, that's the one. So the influencing environment. The school. The school. Their mates. Whenever they meet their friends, the environment, basically the school, also can be an influencing factor. Okay? They become more demanding. When they become more demanding, basically they say, give me, give me, give me, yeah? And they don't want to contribute. The technology, and the distractions that they have that seem to be taking a lot of their time.
The environment around us.
The environment, yes. Okay, the environment from the media to the fashionable environment to the friends to the social media, it all portrays that teenagers have to be totally different. They have to be a breed of their own. Okay? Anything else?
Curiosity.
At that age, they're going through exploration phase, and sometimes out of curiosity, they may try things that could be dangerous or harmful to them. What about isolation?
They close themselves in their own rooms.
Okay. They basically isolate themselves and they do not seem to fit in the environment. They don't want to socialize with family. They don't want to have family visits. Yeah. They prefer to be alone, together. Okay. Birds of feather flock together. Salt Mesa, excuse me. What can we do? Okay. Anything else? What about it? Okay, ignorance. Ignorance from parents on how to raise children may contribute. Okay, one more.
Television,
so the media. Yeah, all of these are true. عنا الأخوات ما محصل لمكان. لو الشباب هناك شوية يفرغوا شوية يجيبوا كراسي إضافية. ما أدري. Find a way. Okay. Yeah, that is a consequence. As a consequence of all these influencing factors, we see some behavior. So now let us talk about some behaviors that we see that may appear to you to be wrong. One of them is lack of respect. Anything else? Excuse me? Okay, lack of understanding of values. Okay, faith. Anything else that you see that you don't like in teenagers? They are bad-tempered, they are stubborn, and they are rebellious, and they want it their own way.
Obedience.
There's no obedience. Now? I didn't hear you. Eating habits, they get into the junk food style. All of these are true. So you know the problem, you know the influencing factors, and now you seem to be knowing also what is wrong. So let me ask you another question. Why do you think they get into all of these things? Why aren't you able to deal with them? Lack of role models.
Keeping distance.
You're not seeing eye to eye. Lifestyle. The gap in perception between parents and children. They're living a different age altogether. Okay. We don't seem to take care of them early enough. And then by the time we want to deal with an issue, it's a bit late.
We buy them with gifts.
We try to blackmail them by buying gifts to them. Yeah, okay.
Sometimes
you want to raise them the way you were raised. The fact they think they know better than you. Yeah. Congratulations. It's just a phase they go through. You just have to accept it and live with it. Okay. Yeah. Now, let me try to give you my understanding of teenagers. First of all, we all need to understand from the age of 9 to the age of 17, that is the age where every single person will go through, and when they go through, they are going through a transition period. They are going through a transition period of shifting from being children to being adults. And in that phase, the priority to them is all about seeking identity, wanting to know who are they. So in seeking identity, what they want to do, they want to explore, they want to try, And as they keep on trying, they are searching for a model. They are searching for a role model. They are searching for good examples. And one thing as human beings, irrespective of age, irrespective of gender, irrespective of nationality, irrespective of creed, irrespective of civilization, as human beings, we need to understand two things. Two things that drive every single person. The motives of life are only two. If we can understand these two, then we can begin to understand other people, and at the same token, understand ourselves. The first motive in life, somehow, we all wake up in the morning, shouting loud and clear, telling the world, we say, I am here. Hello, I am here. Do you hear that? Someone heard me. And someone says, I am also here. You didn't mention me. Sorry. From birth to death, we find ways to say, I am here. For example, just now we've heard a baby, a toddler. What do babies, when they are born, when they're infants, what do? To say, I'm here? They cry. When they cry, what do? We react. We pay attention. We lift them. We hug them. And then they say, oh, you notice that I'm here. Very good. Now they begin to crawl. They begin to crawl now and they begin to walk. What do? To say, I'm here? They break things. They try to touch things that they are not allowed to touch, from hot coffee, to breaking the vase, to holding the knife, to climbing the stairs or the ladders. They try to do things that may appear to us to be dangerous, but they do that in order for them to say, hey, I'm here. When they do that, how do we react? We jump onto them, we lift them, we ensure they didn't get into harm, and then they say, oh, so you notice also that I'm here. Now they begin to go to school. What do children do when they go to school to say, I'm here? You have mainly about two or three categories at school that they would say, I'm here. One group would become troublemakers. When they become troublemakers, suddenly the teachers, the administration, the principal, all the way to parents, attention is being attracted and they say, I am here. Can you see me? Fantastic that you notice me. Another group, they try to be smart, they try to cooperate so they can get the stars and they can be called champions, heroes, whatever. Now they become teenagers. What do teenagers do? Let's begin with boys. What do boys do when they become teenagers? What do they do to say, I'm here? They try to do things out of the way. Examples. What do they do at home to say, I'm here as teenagers? They become rebellious. They appear to lack manners. Now they begin to answer back. Now they become fussy in terms of what food to eat and what food not to eat. They begin to set their own agenda. They begin to have friends. They begin to want to go out. They begin to ask for more independence. And now they become a bit more of teenagers. What do they do when they go to shopping malls as boys? They ask for money. When they go there as a crowd, what do? They dress like, yeah? I don't know what you call these jeans, half, what do you call them? Yeah, they get into all these earrings, they paint their hair, they get into fashionable things, all to say, I am here, notice me. If they have cars, what do to their cars? They spin wheels, they have loud music, they drive fast, and sometimes at the back screen they put their lonely BBM number. Huh? All of that to say, I am here. Hello, I am here. Now let us talk about girls. What do girls do when they become teenagers who say, I'm here? Get into makeup, fancy abayas. Someone is doing like this. I don't know what that means. Yeah, I am here. All the smells, and sometimes they walk. Tuck, tuck, Tak, tak. You say, I am here.
Telephones.
Telephones, different colors, different other things. And sometimes they pretend that they've received a phone call to say, I'm important. Look, I'm receiving calls. And all these stuff. A word of advice to men. Whenever a woman seeks attention, and I'm talking here about a female that is a relative, not any female. I need to qualify that. When a relative female seeks attention, my simple advice to you, make sure you give her the undivided attention. If you don't, you're in trouble. Am I right?
Yes.
So when you go home, this is a question now to you. What do you do at home to say, I am here? Whether you're a man or a woman, whether you're a teenager or an adult, what do you do to say, I'm here? Observe yourself. What do you do in society to say, I'm here? Observe yourself. What do you do at work to say, I'm here? Just observe yourself. There are things you do to seek attention, to say, I'm here. When I travel at the airports, or when I go to busy places, I always like to retreat from the crowd and just observe the different signals people are sending to say, I'm here. And the question is this: why do people demand attention? Why do they want to be noticed?
They are social beings.
They are social beings, absolutely. Even beyond that, why do they seek attention? Why do they want to be noticed?
They want to belong.
They want to belong, absolutely. But there is one more important thing.
They missed it at home.
Maybe they missed it at home, could be. Basically, when people say, I'm here, what they're saying, I exist, recognize me, give me my deserved value. I am worth something. Every single person believes he or she is worth something. And whenever they don't get that worth from the community, from the feedback they get there, they will seek it to say, look, you are not paying attention. You have not yet understood me. You have not yet appreciated me. This is who I am. And once you recognize the person and you give that person the undivided attention and you say, yes, I do understand you. I do appreciate you. Then they say, well done. Now you know who I am. Now, if you come to teenagers specifically, what happens? We have a clash of ideas, of opinion, of beliefs, and of conviction between parents and teenagers. The way teenagers see themselves, they are transforming from being children to being adults. And they believe as adults, they are entitled to have their own choices, to make their own decisions, and to do whatever they pleased, thinking that is part of being an adult. Whereas parents, they say, you are still a child. You do not have enough experience. There are people out there, the environment outside there is unfriendly to you. You may get to bad company. You may get into drugs. You may get into crimes. You may get into wrong stuff. We need to look after you. We need to supervise you. And in that process, the two don't see eye to eye. And when children realize their parents have not yet appreciated them as adults, they say, we are going to show you who we are. You still think that we are children? Let me show you how responsible I am. Let me show you how grown I am. Let me show you how matured I am. So they begin to do all those things to declare that I don't need you as a parent to look after me. I can look after myself. So priority number one is to make sure we appreciate them as they are and we support them in that transformation. We recognize that they're becoming adults and the best thing you can do to them is to begin to give them responsibilities at an earlier age before they get into that transitional phase. In our society, in our community, the one thing that probably is not helping is that we allow our children to be dependent on their parents from the time they are born, probably to the time they get married. We do not teach them independence. We do not teach them self-reliance. We do not teach them the confidence in making right decisions, because they always decisions are made by parents. And as such, they learn to have a 5-star hotel at home, because everything is done for them, they become dependent. When they are babies, they are dependent. When they are children, going to that age of 5, 6, 7 years, they are dependent. They get everything for free. Now they are students, they go to school, they get everything for free. And now they also get on top of that pocket money, they get transportation for free, accommodation for free, medication for free, they get everything for free, leisure for free, pleasure for free, everything for free. Now they go to university, they still get everything for free. And then they finish, they graduate, now they want a wife or a husband, they get that for free as well. Because who finds them a job? It's the parents. Who finds them a spouse? Maybe them, but parents play a big role. Who organizes all these wedding ceremonies? It's parents. Who pays for all of that? It's parents. Who provides accommodation? So if we do that to them, then as a result, today we have a community that is irresponsible, that is dependent. They are not independent, for them to become interdependent. So two things we need to realize here. First, let us recognize children, even when they are children, let us give them their due respect and value as they deserve. Number two, let us teach them from the early age responsibility, taking care of themselves and becoming responsible to every decision they make. It is a paramount, is of a paramount importance that we begin to apply that type of behavior. Some parents come and tell me, but we can't trust them. They cannot make the right decision. I said, yes. When they make those decisions, make sure they are supervised. You coach them, you counsel them, you mentor them, you are with them. Give them an opportunity to make wrong decisions, small as they are, so they can learn from them. And begin at places where it doesn't hurt. As an example, I recall myself as a parent. My boys, when they go, when went through that stage, before I understood all of these tips and hints on how to deal with them, they were 9, 10 years old, 11. Summertime would come because they've done well in school and studies. It's time to reward. They say, I want a reward, I want to buy a watch. As a parent, what do? I take the kid, the boy, to the shop. I ask him, choose a watch. He chooses a watch that is colorful, that is fancy, maybe doesn't even work. He says, I want that. As a father, being an engineer, I go for practicality. I say, look, this is not good. Better buy this one, which is a digital watch. Look, it has dates, it has a watch, it has stopwatch, it has a timer, and then it has all of this stuff. It's good that you buy this one. Plus, it has got all dates, including weeks. It can tell you exactly. And then it has alarms as well. It can wake you up. He says, but I don't like it. I says, no, you don't understand. This one is not good for you. And then you get into the debate. Eventually, they have to give in because it's either my way or highway. So they said, okay, I'll buy it. Within 2 days, they insure that they break it or they lose it because it was not their choice. Then now they want to go and buy clothes. Now they go with the mother. They go there, they look at fancy, colorful clothes, and the mother says, no, that doesn't suit you. This is better for you. No, I don't like it. No, yeah, this suits you. And then eventually, they have to give in. And as a result, they lack confidence in themselves. They keep on relying on a father or a mother to make decisions. All the way to their adulthood. Which means that when they go through that transitional period, and biologically, physiologically, emotionally, and mentally, they are going through a change, then they will begin to be influenced by other people because now they rely on other people to make decisions for them. And when they go out, the first thing that happens to them, when they are with their friends, with their peers, or with the media, the first thing other people do that you as a parent has failed to do, they get valued by their friends, by their peers. They say, wow, wow, you look cool, man. Really? Yeah, wow, look at you there. And that immediately raises their self-esteem in front of their peers. When they come home, what do they hear? They hear the opposite. Girls is the same thing. I always say, in the house, if a father fails to provide the affection to his daughters, they're going to seek it outside. Because usually men at home, they appear to be blind, deaf, and dumb towards women. You hear that? They said, yes! And when they go out, what do they hear? Wow, you look fine, you look elegant, you look beautiful, you look all of these things. And suddenly they hear, though, the self-esteem goes up outside at home. When it comes at home, it has to be quenched, it has to be suppressed. And as a result, you know what? Where do they enjoy being the most? With their peers and outside. Self-esteem is important. The Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said it 1,400 years plus. He said, "Anzilun nasa manazilahum." Anzilun nasa manazilahum. Give everybody their due, deserved position. Everybody is worth something. And how do you demonstrate to the person that you appreciate them? You have to do three things to them. Number one, accept them as they are. Accept them as they are. Your duty is not to change anybody. Nobody has the authority to go and change somebody. The Prophet of Islam himself was told by Almighty Allah that you have no authority to change people. وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا أَفَأَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. If your Lord has willed, He would have transformed everybody into believers. Do you then forcefully coerce people to become believers? إِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغُ. Your duty is to deliver the message. Your duty as parents is to guide, to support your children to become adults. So one thing is that accept them as they are. Number two, find some goodness in them. Find some goodness in them. To find some goodness in them is for you to shift the focus from focusing on problems to focusing on solutions. From focusing on what is wrong to focusing on what is right. Typical modus operandi at home, every time you do something wrong, we will tell you you've done something wrong. We'll counsel you, we'll coach you, we'll tell you, we'll give you a piece of advice. The modus operandi that we are promoting and advocating for is catch me doing something right. As an example, imagine a kid comes home with the score card. All A's, 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 except one has got a red circle. What's typically the conversation between a parent and a kid? How does it start? We focus on the red. How come you got this on a red? We thought you were clever. What happened to you? So we focus on the mistake. 5 A's. 1 E, we focus on the 1 E. At school, when does a student get to see the principal? When there's a problem. At work, when does an employee get to see the big manager? Or when does the manager call the employee? Same thing. When I go home and tell my children, I want to have a conversation with you, what's the first thing they think of? I have done something wrong. Even worse, when you look at the mirror in the morning, what are you searching for? mistakes, flaws. You're searching for flaws. You see a white hair, shock of your life. You find a way to make it disappear. You have a spot somewhere, you don't like it. You search for mistakes. So typically, as human beings, I don't know why, we tend to love searching for mistakes. What we are advocating is search for what is right. We are told that Jesus, peace be upon him, when he was walking with his disciples, he passed upon a dead goat, a dead sheep. The disciples said, what a stinky smell, a rotten smell that is coming from this carcass. Jesus, peace be upon him, said, Ma abyadha asnanaha, what wonderful white teeth does this carcass has. He searched for something right and he promoted it. I recommend as parents you go and buy a book called Whale Dung. Whale Dung. Whale, you know the big fish? Whale Dung. It sounds like well done by Ken Blanchard. The gist of the story is this. It's a small booklet. A person who was successful in his career, really going places, being promoted, becoming successful, the more he went up the ladders, the lesser he saw of his family, because he had more responsibilities. And somehow the communication gap between him and his family began to grow. When he would go home, the wife would be complaining, children would be complaining, you're not spending time with us, you don't care, you don't this, nowadays you're too busy with your work, blah, blah, blah. And then he would try to say, look, I'm doing all of this for you, etc. I'm really working hard so I can give you a nice, comfortable living, etc. And every day, every week, they would have a fight, a quarrel at home. So realizing he's about to break his marriage, he decided to take time out. And they went on a holiday, a family holiday. Part of the family holiday was to go and visit an aquarium. And there they had one of these shows where the dolphins and the big whales would make all these acrobat movements. As he was sitting with his family observing these fish jumping, he said, look, this is unnatural to the fish to make all these movements. The trainer was able to communicate with the fish when they don't speak the same language. How did he succeed to convince the fish to do what he wants when I speak the same language as my family and you can't seem to communicate? There's something fundamentally wrong. Now I need to know the trick. So after the show, he approaches the trainer. He says, can you tell me? What's the secret? This is my situation. And here you are communicating with the fish and you are able to make the fish do these movements immaculately. What's the secret? He says, the secret is very simple. You want to know the secret? Please go and buy the book. Okay, since I don't have shares on the book, I'll tell you. The trainer says, or the trainer said, it's very simple. When we catch these big fish from the ocean and we bring them here in the aquarium, in the pool, every time the fish does something we like, we reward. Every time it does something we don't like, we turn a blind eye as if we haven't seen. And the fish begins to learn the only way to attract attention is to do something these people like. And then we begin to build steps, movements, till we perfect it the way we want. My suggestion to you is this. So the book, the gist of the book is catch me doing something right. At home, when your children do something wrong, pretend you haven't seen because they are saying, hey, I'm here. Whenever they do something right, pay attention, say, I have noticed you. I have noticed you. I have noticed you. It may appear to be difficult in the beginning. And the question is, you choose. The minute you make the game and they realize when I do something right, I get attention. When I do something wrong, nobody pays attention. Eventually, they begin to want to do the things you want rather than the things you don't want. Because that is where you're paying attention. Please remember this statement. Subordinates respect what the boss inspects. At home we'll say, children respect what the parents inspect. What you inspect, they'll give you more of. What pleases my boss fascinates me. So by you paying attention to the right things, they'll give you more. Just now, 5 minutes ago, my son sends me a message. I'm going to read it to you. It's in Arabic. He says, my marks out of 30. Social studies, 23. Physics, 30. Sports, 90 out of 100. English, 28. Islamic studies, 29. Chemistry, 29. Social skills, how much did he get there? 91 out of 100. Mathematics, 27. Arabic, 28. I didn't ask him to send me this, but he knows I only want good news. What does he give me? He gives me good news. And then I respond immediately to him. Masha Allah, هَكَذَا عَاهِدْتُكَ مُتَفَوِّقًا وَمُتَمَيِّزًا بَارَكَ اللَّهُ فِيكَ وَإِلَى الْأَمَامِ دَوْمًا إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ. I haven't met him. What do you think his self-esteem is right now? Proud of himself. When I go home, I can guarantee you he won't come and say salam alaikum to me. And he's going to show me his big smile, because he'll be waiting for more praises from me. Yeah? That's the secret. Focus on what is right, and they will give it to you. Is the message clear? So that's the first thing as human beings we seek. Value me. Value me. How do you value me? Number two, every single morning, we all wake up, and we all tune in to one famous radio station. It's the most famous radio station in the world, and it's called WWI-FM. Have you heard of that station? Hello, good morning. This is WWI-FM coming to you live. You haven't heard of it? It's called What's In It For Me. What's In It For Me. There is no free lunch. Everything we do, we want something in return. What we want in return could be tangible or it can be intangible. Could be physical or it could be moral. But we want something in return. So whenever someone does a movement, whenever someone does a gesture, they want something in return. Whenever they serve you, they help you, they support you, they listen to you, they talk to you, whatever it is, they want something in return. Do you know what your children want? What's in it for them? What's in it for them to obey you and to do it your way? What's in it for them to work really hard at studies? What's in it for them to become good citizens? What's in it for them to subscribe to your values? What's in it for them? You need to understand that. And the best way to understand it is to have a dialogue with them. In that dialogue, how can you persuade them? How can you convince them that what you have is better than what they think? Very simple. You need to dance around identity. The first thing you always do with an identity, you praise the identity, you talk about the identity of what we call this the self-ideal. Talk to them as if they are already there. Talk to them as if they are champions. Talk to them as if they are already successful. Talk to them as if they are already there. And just tell them, this is my expectation of you and I know you are there. Thereafter, everything else you do, they will go with it because now they have a clear identity. Our youth today have no identity. They have a lost identity. They don't know who to follow. Some of you have said that. Who is the role model to them? Is it the media? Is it the social media? Is it the superstars? Is it the football stars? Is it the singers? Is it the actors? Is it you? Is it the teacher? Who is the role model? And on what basis? Observe the way the media plays, the advertising media, not only to children, but also to us as adults. They all dance around the identity. And the question is, who are you? Ask your children, who are you? What identity do you have? Let them find 1, 2, 3, maximum 5 words to describe themselves. And these have to be the aspirational identity that they want to aim for. And once they are clear about that identity, your duty is to reflect that identity to them every time they live that identity. What did I say to my son? I have always, هَكَذَا عَهِدْتُكَ, this is how I've always been observing you, seeing you, noticing in you. مُتَمَيِّزًا وَمُتَفَوِّقًا, exceptional and always successful. So now he has got two identities. I am exceptional. I am always successful. I am exceptional. I'm always successful. During this weekend, we had a gathering with our schoolmates. And now we are all old people. We have children. We gather them. They were with us, etc. And then I asked for those boys, it was all boys, between the age of 9 to the age of 15 to come closer to me. And all I did to them, within five minutes, they were so energized. Anything I did to them, anything I said to them, they would say, yes, we want to be with you. There was no magic behind it. Because parents said, can you give them, can you tell them how to behave? Can you do this? Please give them a good dose. So I said, okay, leave it to me. So when they gathered, I said, look, your age between 9 and 15, what does that mean? I said, what do you mean? I said, are you now, do I call you boys or do I consider you as adults? What do you think they said? I said, we are adults. I said, wow, yes, you are adults. Identity number one, we are adults. I said, now, tell me the difference between a child, between a boy and adults. Tell me 3 things boys do. They say, they're troublemakers. They don't listen. They're disrespectful. They are this. I said, oh, boys, oh, this is what they do. I said, okay, give me 3 qualities adults have. They are responsible. They make good decisions. And they are always respectable. I said, now, do you want in this trip to be irresponsible, disrespectful, troublemakers? They said, no, we want to be this. I said, okay, there is one thing that is a difference between a child and an adult. Eventually, I cajole them to say, adults are responsible, they realize the responsibility, and children are irresponsible, they are carefree because they are dependent. I said, now, if you agree on the word responsibility, let me suggest with you that adults are responsible, you specifically at your age, you have to be responsible with 3 things. You want to be successful? They said, yes. You want to be at the top? They said, yes. Do you want to be champion? They said, yes. Do you want your parents to be proud of you? They said, yes. I said, look, be responsible on 3 things. Number one, your relationship with Allah is your responsibility. Don't wait for parents to remind you about praying. You are responsible. Because you are worshipping Allah, you're not worshipping your parents. Now tell me something you will do to tell me that you are responsible in your relationship with Allah. And then I asked them that question. And they said, well, I have to pray on time. I said, wonderful, what else? I have to make sure I don't miss a prayer. I said, wonderful, what else? I have to make sure that I recite the Quran every now and then. I said, wonderful, what else? And they kept on mentioning, I said, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And someone was writing them. I said, now, second thing you have to be responsible is in your studies. Because when you study, it is you who is benefiting, not your parents. Would you agree? They said, yes. I said, now, tell me 3 things for you that you can do to demonstrate to me that you are a responsible adult in your studies. Without failure, they mentioned about 20 things. From studying hard, from paying attention to the class, from participating in the class, from doing their homework, from looking after their bags, from preparing for the exams. And they kept on mentioning many, 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 many things. I said, wonderful. I'm really, really, really proud of you. Because you seem to know what is right, you can make the right decisions. Number three, if you want to be successful as an adult, your manners will speak louder than anything else. With manners, your behaviors, your attitude, your habits. Tell me three things a responsible adult has in the form of manners, in the form of attitude, in the form of behavior, in the form of habits that truly makes him or her successful. They talked about respect, they talked about appreciating others, they talked about looking after the environment, being good listeners, and being responsible, mentioned many, many things. I said, now, let us repeat it one more time. Are you children or are you adults? I said, we are adults. What is the difference between a child and an adult? A child is irresponsible, an adult is responsible. Are you responsible? They say, yes. Are you responsible in what? They said, in our relationship with Allah. Give me something that makes you responsible with Allah. Prayers, fantastic. Second, are you responsible for what? For our studies. And by the time we finished, they were so energized. The next day, I asked them the same question, and they were all able to answer that. I said, now, I'm going to reward you. With that reward, a promise that you're going to keep that personality. You're going to keep that identity, because I have a lot of respect for you. And everybody who gave them a token of reward. Thereafter, I didn't have to search for them. They were searching for me. So there's no magic behind it, my dear brothers and sisters. Key thing with children, key thing with adults, key thing with teenagers is to appreciate people and to give them the deserved respect and value. If you can do that, you are starting to appreciate people, you are starting to win people. Once you respect those people, you show their appreciation, and you show that you value them, thereafter they say, you understand me, you know me very well, you are my friend, you and me are together. Then you win their trust. Once you win their trust, you can mold them in any way you like. The answers that I've given lectures and Friday prayers, Friday speeches on this subject, and it's available on Facebook and YouTube. Yeah, but inshallah, we can have another session in Arabic. And it's been recorded. And then my best suggestion is that you now, as parents, it's been recorded. If you want a copy, contact the organizers. And I think it's going to be uploaded on YouTube. So please take the time to translate it to your families. But inshallah, we have a question here at the front. There was a question here. Muhammad? No, Muhammad. Third row, fourth row. Ladies, prepare your questions as well.
Thank you, Sheikh Alfa, for the lecture today. But I think it does not only apply to children, teenagers, but it also applies to the husband and wives. If we start doing with our wives the same thing, the children of the pick it up.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, indeed. But we talk specifically about children because a lot of parents complain about that. We can have another session to talk about husbands and wives. His and hers. We have a question there. I don't know, is that Suha? I don't know. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Microphone. No, I'll pay microphone.
Yeah. Do you ever discipline your kids, means ground them, if they really do bad, like don't do their homework, do you believe on grounding them or take something away which is they really like it?
I used to do that. I no longer do that. I used to do that.
Not anymore.
Not anymore. I don't believe in grounding. I don't believe in disciplining. I don't believe in punishing. Why I do that? Because the self-esteem is fragile. تقدير الذات يعني يمكن يكون مهزوز. If I fail to win them, somebody else is going to win them. So anytime they may do something wrong, we have a chat. And usually it is a one-to-one, not in front of their brothers and sisters. The trick that I do sometimes, I say, I'm going somewhere, I need company. And I say, let me see, who do I need today? I need Umar, come with me. They come with me, and in the car, we just talk, and the way to structure negative feedback, if you call it negative feedback, There is no feedback that is positive or criticism. There is no positive criticism or constructive criticism. Criticism is always wrong. So the way we do it, we divide the conversation into three phases. We call it the sandwich feedback, PBP. PBP, person, behavior, person. As a person, self-esteem I protect. I say, do you know that being my son, how proud I am of you? Do you realize that when you were born, we were so pleased to have you? Do you realize the things you do that make me really proud, etc., etc.? Do you know how much we love you? Do you know how much, we would do the impossible to make you happy and to make you successful, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, value, 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 and how much we value the person? And they say, with a person who is successful like you, who belong to this wonderful family, there are some behavior that are alien to this personality. And then I begin to point with the left hand away. I say, for example, and I begin to mention the bad behavior. For example, using bad language. For example, taking other people's stuff. For example, taking money without permission. For example, being home late. For example, not participating in the class. For example, and I mentioned several examples. Amongst the examples, the one thing they've done wrong. Without me saying, I have noticed you. Remember, when they do wrong, we meant to turn a blind eye. So I mentioned five examples. Amongst them would be one of them, what they've done wrong. I said, such things do not fit this person that is in front of me that has got my respect. And then I conclude with the last P, which is my expectation. You know what is my expectation of you? I know you very well. Being proud of you, I know you will always make the right decision. Number two, and I know whenever you make a mistake, you will correct it immediately and do what is right. And I'm proud of you. And then when you finish, I said, how about we stop for an ice cream? Yeah? So we conclude with a high. Yeah? How about if we stop for an ice cream? Or maybe one of these healthy drinks, the juice, whatever. I said, good idea. And then we conclude with that, we go back home happy. I protect the self-esteem, showed how much respect I have, and my expectation. What do you think they're going to do the next day? They'll try to. Now I've got the results. I could have done it the opposite, but I know I'm going to hurt them. For them to pick themselves up, to find the positive energy, is going to take them a long time. Adding to that, because it's a very good question.
Thank you.
People who are angry, people who have a hard personality, people who seem to be moody all the time, people who criticize and people who blame others and people who do that, the one thing those people have is that they lack self-love. Self-esteem is low. And as a result, they hate themselves, they hate their families, and they hate the environment, and they hate the whole world. And as a result, they will go into destructive behavior to penalize themselves and punish parents. So very critical is to protect self-esteem. Sometimes I lose it. I get angry. But then we quickly recover. Yeah. Sometimes the mother does it. But we try not to make it a habit. Every now and then, yes, it will happen because we are human. And specifically when we are under stress. Like at the end of the month with my wife taking all the money, then I get stressed. Can't even afford to shave, so. Yes, ma'am. Okay. What school is it?
I'm in Musana.
Musana? Yes. Okay. So thank you very much for the positive feedback. Two is that I cannot attend, for now at least, because my calendar is usually 3 months in advance fully booked. Nevertheless, what we meant about relationship with Allah, although it is religious, is all centered around values and principles. It's all about integrity. It's about honesty. It's about doing what is right. It's about telling the truth. And these are universal values. Yeah. So although we do talk to that, it's all about being self-conscious, being self-driven. I don't need someone to supervise me. I don't need someone to police me for me to do right. And that is the whole concept of Islam, is that all types of worship that we do in Islam, they are all self-driven. We don't have cameras watching people praying or missing. We don't have fingerprints in the mosque to see who's attended, who's absent. In the month of Ramadan, we don't have random sample of blood to see who has been cheating during the day. We don't have accountants to do auditing about the financial matters for people to know how much they have to pay zakah. It's all about self-driven, self-conscious, self-auditing. Yeah. So I think it is with that concept that we tell, yes, your relationship with Allah is your responsibility. So that they don't need to hide from anybody to do something that is wrong, because they realize, yeah, I have to be honest with myself. In schools, and this is an experiment that was done in the United States. One of the schools, what they did, the principal, day one, he stood there and faced all students, says, in this school, every student is an A student. So this is the identity. In this school, every student is an A student. And you and us, we are going to team together to ensure you maintain your A. It's not that you achieve it, you maintain it. As a team, we're going to work together, because in this school, we have none other than champions. Injecting that moral energy into them, self-esteem, making them believe in themselves. In Oman, we have an example, the math genius. Math genius is nothing that is so special. The whole idea behind it, when children come there, from day one, they are called genius. Genius Muhammad, genius Saeed, genius Sarah, genius Maryam. Everybody's a genius. Within 1 month, they prove to themselves that they are geniuses, because they can do something their parents can't. So they go home and they show off. After 3 months, we invite them facing a crowd, and then they begin to present their talents. And everybody, wow! They say, yes, I'm a genius. Say, now because you're a genius in math, we are a genius in all subjects. They go to school and you know what? They believe that they're genius and they become genius. So you as a teacher, my suggestion is this. If you can from day one tell your children, tell your students, in this class we only have the A students. We are going to work together to make it. And you make them believe that. And you say, a classical difference, I wish at home, in schools and society we can implement. There are two ways to have a dialogue. The worst of all dialogues is for you to tell. When you tell, you're spoon feeding. When you tell, it's your ideas, it's your world. The best thing with children is dialogue. Just ask questions, let them give you answers. Whenever they give you answers, write them. Say, look at this. Do you see what I see here? What I see here are intelligent people. What I see here are people who are knowledgeable. What I see is people who are responsible. What I see people here who have to be proud of themselves. Do you know if I tell your parents that you gave me these answers, how they're going to feel? They're going to be feel proud of you. Do you know if I bring this principal right here? Do you know if I bring His Majesty and he sees this? He's going to say, these are my future leaders. Come on, everybody, be proud of yourself. Let them shout. Wow! It's good. Positive energy. Expectation. Personality. Identity. Always keep it there. And I can guarantee you, if you do that once, twice, and then every now and then, I don't know if they allow you to have sweets in your pocket. Yeah, you can do that. A reward, could be stars, could be something. Yeah. That goes a long way to really raise self-esteem. Yeah. All the best. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
It's a short question. I have my brother, he's smaller of me, and sometimes I used to buy some small gifts for him. But the problem is that's not really, I mean, the gifts are sometimes some valuable, and I cannot allow for me to buy every month this kind of gifts. And it's the same as you mentioned about the watches. I know that this decision is wrong exactly. And I try to convince him that it is really wrong, but he still wants to buy what he wants. And you know, sometimes I'm buying and it's really so sorrow for me inside, but still I'm buying and I'm not really happy with this.
Yeah.
And, finally, it's like bad experience. Sometimes I used to buy by my decision and again it is bad. So.
Yeah. Okay. Now, good question. Normally with gifts, when you buy gifts to them, do not make it conditional. Give them gifts that are not connected to anything that they're doing. Otherwise, it becomes performance-based. If they do this, they get. Do not make it conditional. My suggestion is that with gifts, make it... The best gifts are the ones that are full of surprises. And have a variety. Could be as simple as a pen, could be as expensive as an expensive watch, even a bike, whatever it is, or a computer. Every time you do that, as you give the gift, reinforce the same message. Because you mean so much to me. Because you mean so much to me. Because I value you. Because I have so much regard for you. I thought of buying. Today I was thinking of you and I bought you a gift. Yeah? So don't make it that every month I'm going to buy you one. Then it becomes already an expectation, it becomes an entitlement. Do not make gifts as entitlement. Yeah? Make it random, and not only for the children, the wives would agree, they also like to have surprises as gifts. Am I right? Could be as simple as a rose, a box of chocolate, that you end up eating anyway, but never mind. You let her open the box, and then you and children have it all. Could be a simple message, a simple gesture, or a dinner out. Let's go for a night dinner together. Whatever it is, yeah. Small gestures they do matter. So do not make the gifts conditional. Make them, they just so happen because of our relationship. It is not the gift that matters; it is the gesture that matters. Yeah. Tafadhal. Expectation. Okay, you get the mic so that people can hear you.
Don't you think high expectation can lead sometimes to disappointment, especially if the capabilities of the children, for example, you are saying you can be made, you cannot. So in some cases, I think this can affect their...
Good question. Expectations may lead into... specifically if they're not good at something. If they're not good at something, you keep on telling me you're good at this, you're good at that, but then they cannot do it because they don't have the talent, they don't have the skills, etc. They may get demoralized. My suggestion is that find, as your children, they're all exceptional in one area or the other. Whatever area you discover that they have talent, facilitate for that talent to be developed so that they can shine. You see, in the communities, not only in Oman, worldwide, we don't have an issue of ordinary people. We have enough of them. What we lack are the extraordinary people. And between being ordinary and being extraordinary is just 1 inch, or 1 millimeter, or 1 small gesture. The difference between the first winner in the Grand Prix Formula and the second, what is the difference between them? A millisecond. The first one is extraordinary, the second one is ordinary. Between the first and the fifth is less than 3 seconds. In horse racing, in sports, in being successful, the difference is just that much. So in your children, begin from the early age to discover they are different. Find whatever they are good at, make it grow. For example, at home, every single one of them has got a title. Based on their strength. And we keep on embedding that, developing it, giving them an opportunity to discover more talent. Whatever talent they discover, they get a title for it. Omar, as an example, he's independent, he is courageous, he can face a crowd, and whatever circumstances, he'll always tell you the truth. Now, in his school, he's been labeled as Al Jazeera, what do you call that, a newscaster. No? So now he's got the title of international TV broadcasting. Usama, on the other hand, he always thinks logic, strategic, he just wants to talk about big subjects. So we called him a leader, strategic leader. Sarah, on the other hand, she is always reading, drawing, and doing all this stuff. Yeah? And then you tell her, you are an intellectual person. Yeah? So everybody got. Muhammad is sociable. Throw him in any crowd. He stutters, whatever. Throw him anywhere. Within 3 minutes, he'll know everybody. We say, you are a fantastic diplomat. Yeah? So everybody find what they're good at. Let them believe they're good at that because what they are, that's the talent. And keep, nurture it for them to shine. Once they shine, other people are going to tell them the same thing. When other tell them, it reaffirms. So sometimes, for example, when Usama is with me, he's young, 11, 12 years old. When I introduce him to people, I say, let me introduce you to one of the great people in my life. This is Mr. Usama. And Usama, he always likes to talk about strategic matters. And he always wants to think big. Plenty of ideas. Now imagine Usama, 11 years, I'm introducing him to a stranger who is older than him. What is the first thing the stranger is going to do to Usama? Respect. He's going to speak to him in that language. But typically, most of the time, I used to do it in the past, I meet my friend, and I've got my kid. What do? I make him negligent. Doesn't even do anything. I just go and speak to him, speak, etc. When we finish, we go. Don't introduce him to the kid. How does he feel? He feels small. And he remains small. Yeah? So I think we need to facilitate. Unfortunately, sometimes it happens, someone is introduced and says, my kid, he says, I hope he's good like you. He says, oh, he's hopeless. In front of him. Oh, hopeless. So now, can you imagine the identity of giving in front of a stranger? He hates himself. Next time, he doesn't want to come with me. I hope that clears. Thank you.
Wa alaikum assalam. I have like three questions, but I'm just making them short. The first question, what I've noticed in our society that we have boys and girls outside roaming around and all, and some brothers, they see their sisters doing something wrong, or, you know, opposite. Let's say for a girl seeing her brother smoking or something that we noticed a lot. What is the thing that they're supposed to do? Usually, the second question is, usually, if you do something as a brother or as a sister, an adult, and you see a younger brother doing something wrong, if you try to talk to them or you try to pull them aside, the parents, they would come and tell you, why did you do that? Why didn't you tell us? You don't have the right to talk to him, or you don't have the right to tell him what to do or not to do. That is the second one. Third one is, when we are angry, we start taking decisions that is not mentally right. What is the thing to provide our anger aside and come down and try to talk in proper manners?
Yeah, good questions. I think as brothers and sisters, trust needs to start early. That we have to see that we are there for each other. We're not there against each other. We're not there to spy on each other. We're not there for this, etc. Trust has to be there. When trust is there, people are willing to confide their secrets to each other. And then they're willing to seek advice from each other. And in that, parents need to use that, promote trust among themselves, because it's easier for brothers and sisters to reveal secrets to themselves without telling parents. So normally, for example, at home, when I notice something wrong, I don't tell them. I send one of the brothers or sisters to go and fix it. I said, recently I have noticed this and that on your brother or on your sister, and I need your help. I know they would listen to you. Yeah? And I leave it to your judgment on how you go and talk to them. And they know the style is PBP. Yeah? And then I said, I trust you're going to do the right job, and I know you're going to do the right job, and may Allah, through you, guide your brothers and sisters to do the right thing. 3 days later, if that person doesn't come back to me to tell me they've done it, I'll go and ask, I said, did you approach the person? What was the response? Yeah. And then that's it. So In answering your question number one, promote trust among themselves. They are there for each other, not there against each other, in order so that they can confide to each other and look after each other. Because I'd rather they have advice at home from their brothers and sisters rather than them seeking advice from somebody else outside. Two, when they do something wrong, anybody, irrespective of age, gender, nationality, whatever, never tell people off in front of others. It has to be a one-to-one. And when you do that in one-to-one, it has to be again PBP. Never touch the self-esteem. You come and tell me something's wrong with me, I become reactive. It doesn't matter. I may pretend to be strong and yes, okay, I'm listening to you, etc. But inside me, I'm boiling. So never ever give feedback in front of people. Always has to be quietly, just like we have done to how about an ice cream, yeah? Make it as a journey, because you want to build, you want to protect the long-term relationship. Number three, it was about angry, being angry. In being angry, the minute emotions take over, logic disappears. So when that happens, the best thing you can do is buy time. Buy time. The way to buy time is to either walk out, walk away, do something totally different, change your focus, take some deep breaths, do whatever. But never stay there facing that thing. Change your focus. A man came to the Prophet, peace be upon him, he says, please guide me. He said, La taghdab, never get angry. He says, Zidni, tell me more. He says, never get angry. Number three, never get angry. And then he says, if you happen to get angry and you're standing, sit down. If you're still angry, lie down. If you're still angry, go and wash. If you're still angry, go and pray. In other words, keep yourself busy. Distract yourself for anger to subside. And the one thing about emotions, please remember this. The only time negative emotions will have power over you is when you react to them. Anger, resentment, frustration, hate, name them. The minute you react, they caught you. If you fail to react, they have no power over you. The opposite is also true. With positive emotions, the minute you react to positive emotions, they elevate you. So the trick is between thought and emotions. If you react to emotions, they got you. Thoughts that are emotionalized become magnetized and attract similar thoughts. So when you are angry, you'll begin to see everything that is wrong because you are attracting similar thoughts. Based on that emotion, it becomes a magnet. When you distract yourself, you take the power away. Yeah? Thank you. Ladies.
Do you have any more questions?
A question here, and then we need to go to the ladies as well. Because ladies, I think there's a lady there raising her hand. Let's agree to take two more questions from the ladies, two more questions from the gents, and then we call it a day.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
First of all, I thank you for this wonderful speech. I haven't noticed so many ideas. But there's one concern of letting children do whatever they want. Sometimes they do mistakes, not of making themselves noticed, or they maybe for desire, appetite, or something like that. So if there is no torture or no
punishment,
they are free to do it. So that's maybe concern.
Yeah.
Making mistake.
Good question. Yeah. Can we give our children absolute freedom? The answer is no. For example, if I see my child getting to drugs, I don't say I'm not noticing. If I see my child beginning to steal, it does not mean that I'm closing my blind eye. If I begin to see them lying all the time and don't have a blind eye, all I'm suggesting, there are ways to correct these behaviors. Do not confront directly. Confrontation always leads to resistance. And usually by the time they get there, it means you as a parent have failed to do things right early. By then it is already too late. Because people don't get into drugs, don't get into wrongdoing just like that. It is a gradual steps. So if I fail to win their trust and respect from the early age, eventually they may begin to do all these wrong things. Establishing a dialogue. Telling stories, for example. For example, I want my children to be away from this. I give a story. I say, Subhanallah, today a parent came and told me about this and this about his son. Do you know how the parent is feeling right now? Do you know that this child now that is totally addicted to drugs, what is happening? Do you know about his health? Do you know about this, etc., etc.? I really feel sorry for that parent. And I said, I hope that one day you can retrieve your son and have your son recovered, etc., etc. And then, once I finish the story, I turn to my kid and say, you know what? I am blessed to have you because I know you do the right thing. إِيَّاكَ عَانِي فَفَمِي يَجَارَ لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرًا. So I think, and that is why, if you look at the way children grow, from birth to 2 years, give them unconditional affection. Hugging, cuddling, kissing them. From the age of 2 to the age of 4, give them unconditional love. Keep on telling them how much you love them. From the age of 4 to the age of 7, it is when they begin to find a role model. They want to follow someone. And to children between the age of 4 to the age of 7, they see a father and a mother as the best example. And that is the time you see in studies, stories begin to come. That's when they begin to go to school, to kindergarten. And it's all about story, storytelling. And that is the time you begin to embed the values that you want at that age. If you fail to do that age, now they're teenagers, then you have no one to blame except yourself. Yeah. Thank you. Ladies? Halas? It's the same questions? Okay. We'll take that.
So we have two more questions from them.
And we've got a lady there as well. So three questions and then we close the day.
Sheikh Hassan, thank you very much for this good speech. For children, energetic children,
hyperactive.
Most of us, they do have energetic children. What is the best recipe to transform this energy into something useful to them before it becomes useful to their parents?
Thank you. Hyperactive children. Hyperactive children, make sure that you give them enough physical activities. Exhaust them through physical activities. Do not imprison them, confine them. And unfortunately, our schools need to change. Schools were not meant for children. We are all born uninhibited, and we are all born fearless. And the first thing the schools do, they inhibit and they instill fear. Sorry about teachers. I know it's not your fault. It's an institution. There are now some schools that have no chairs, no tables. It's all free. The best way children learn is when they move, not when they sit. So I would love to see schools transforming now to uninhibit children when they go to school. Because when are they most energetic? It's during breaks. Why? Because they are uninhibited. Plenty of energy. But through plenty of that energy, make it as fun. Yeah? So if you have children, this is a mother who lost her father, her husband through an accident, and now she had one son, and she had, I think, 2 or 3 daughters. And the son being lonely, alone, the only male member in the house, he, of course, was hyperactive, and the only thing he can do, the mother, not having anybody to trust, to allow her son to interact with, she confided her son inside the house. School. So the only thing the son would do is break doors, kick his sisters, break things, become rebellious, and she had enough of him. So she said, what do I do? I said, all you have to do is take him to the beach. Give him a ball. Let him swim. Let him play with the ball. When he comes home, buy him a hammer and buy him nails. And get him some wood. Ask him to make something out of it. Exhaust his energy. So that when the night comes, he is peaceful. Then he can sleep. She did it, and it worked. Yeah? So that is it. If they're hyperactive, don't confide them. Let them release that energy in the right way.
Last question from the gents.
Yes, and then we have one final from the ladies.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam alaikum.
Sheikh Hassan, just follow up to this question because I was asking the same question. Now to, what do you call, to consume that energy in energies, you know, you need some activities at home.
Yes.
And now everybody, most of us can work up to 5 or to 6. And then when they go back, they are almost tired. And when, if you have more than 5 or 6 kids, you know, when you go home, you find your wife saying, I'm really fed up with this kind of, you know, kids. Can we really find a solution for them? Because you cannot find an activity every day to give Muhammad or give him, take him to the beach or something. Thank you, Sheikh.
Thank you. Where there is a will, there is a way. Number one. Number two, who is telling you to stay at work till 5? What I believe about people who stay longer at work, this is something I have learned from one of my previous bosses who have a really revere and respect. He says, if you stay longer at work, it's one of the three. It's either you are incompetent, or you are inefficient, or you are overloaded. I'm not going to mention places. That is one. Two, creativity is the name of the game. In Japan, every house has got a workshop. Every house. They spend their free time inventing things, finding ways to do things. If you have boys at home, my suggestion is this. Go and buy them some scrap. Engine, bicycles, things that are damaged, broken TV, and give them to play with. Keep them busy, outside the house, so they don't break the vase, so the wife doesn't ask you to buy another more expensive one. Yeah, outside the house. And then give them targets. How to use nature to do things. Handicrafts. Today we lack today people who have got physical skills. We have IT people, we have all these about auditors, it's all about using the skills, yeah? We don't have places to develop that talent. You can do that at home. And then when you have time, sit with them and play. For example, one of the things you can do, teach them how to change tires. And then every month, you rotate these tires in the car. Yeah? It's one of the things that is useful that they can learn to do. And every time they do it, reward them. Instead of giving 300 bezels or 500 bezels to a dealer there, give it to your children. Teach them how to wash cars. Instead of you paying 1 rial, tell them, look, come and help me. Yeah, you wash a car, I pay the 1 rial, I'll give you 1 rial. They would love it. Yeah? So find different things, from farming to gardening to handicraft to other things, and organize sports. Do many things. Have a basket, you know this basket thing in the house? Teach them how to play basket. Yeah? It's a sport, they love it. Badminton, yeah? It's a very simple thing. They can learn. No? Not badminton, you have this issue like Marisha, squash. Not squash. No, there's this very light ball that... All these types of sports, teach them.
Question?
Last question.
Assalamu
alaikum.
Thank you very much for this revealing lecture. I have actually two questions. You know, at work, they tell us as adults, actually one of the coaching things for managers and people is that they need to give specific criticism and specific feedback. And here you're telling us to turn a blind eye. It's like we're not giving specific, but rather burying the actual misgiving that the child has. So my fear is, will they grow up as adults, not people who do not accept criticism easily? Maybe at work, because we live in a real world and you always get criticism, maybe at work or other places. So will that affect how they develop as adults? That's one. The second question that I have is, how do you keep them motivated? You teach them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and about Akhirah and all that, and you do dua and everything. But how do you keep kids motivated? Even, I mean, in the beginning it has to be external, and then it becomes internal. So So what's the best way?
Thank you. Two good questions. Thank you. The first one about criticism, when you are adults, but then you understand. And usually even adults at work, we say, for me to give you feedback, I have to have a contract with you. And that contract says, there are specific behaviors that you want to change, and every time they happen, you agree that I'm going to give you feedback. And then feedback is seen as a gift, rather than as a criticism. Yeah? At that age, as adults, you understand. As children, even when they are children, they will receive criticism. In schools, for example, they receive criticism. Sometimes they get bullied by their friends. When they come home, what do? You tell them the opposite. You tell them, look, I know you better. And this is what I think of you. Whatever that people tell you, it's up to you to accept it. But if you ask me, this is who I see. So you protect the self-esteem. It happened even to the Prophet of Islam. When he used to go out inviting people, he would come home withdrawn, exhausted, sometimes with the disparity. And his wife Khadija would tell him, look, no. You are a person with a message. You have a noble message. And keep on going. Do not pay attention to that. So indeed, we need to differentiate between children and adults. With children, always protect their self-esteem. Whenever they get negative feedback, tell them, no, I know you better. That is not who you are. This is who you are. And then let them know specific behaviors through dialogue. Let them tell you what is right and what is wrong. You don't tell them. Because if they say it, they own it. They own it. If you say it, it's what you say. It's your idea. Yeah? So always encourage them to tell you what is right and what is wrong. And then ask them, what decision would you take? They will always say, I want to take the right decision. Say, I respect you and I trust your decision. And then, if you want, you can add one more. What support do you need from me for you to be successful? As of their motivation, usually I keep on saying, when the identity is strong, motivation becomes intrinsic. It comes from within. When identity is weak, people wait for the extrinsic motivation from outside to motivate them. And the best motivation is the one that comes from within. How does it come from within? When people believe in themselves. So we need to make people believe in themselves, instill that belief in them that they are right people, they're good people, they're noble people. In conclusion, I would say, no person on earth feels that they are hopeless or useless. Everybody feels that they have something to offer. It's up to us to nurture that person, because you all have some goodness in us. We just need to create that the right environment to support people for them to become successful. I've had people who are willing to commit suicide. And within half an hour, change the shift, paradigm shift, suddenly they began to see that it is them who is losing, simply because they've been allowing others to influence them. And suddenly they said, look, if it has to be, it is up to me. And now I'm going to lead my life from being a spectator to being a player, from being a passenger to being a driver. We have to drive our lives in the right direction with confidence.
Just an advice.
In what?
Just regarding reading, because we are only there and
reading, yes. Yes. Reading. Today, we are lucky to have Uncle Google. You ask him anything and he tells you. I don't know whether it is him or her. Nevertheless, I think reading is really important. Go to Google, ask any question, everything I have said, I'm sure you can find it one way or the other in the Google. And it's not the knowledge that is going to give you power. It is the applied knowledge that will give you power. Doesn't matter what you know, it's what you put to practice. So you better learn one strategy, practice it, learn it, and please remember one final statement. Anything that is worth doing well, anything that is worth doing well is worth doing poorly the first time. Better start poorly and keep on developing till you become well. Don't wait to become perfect in one day. Start poorly and keep on building on it. One day you'll perfect it. اللهم اجعل اجتماعنا هذا اجتماع مرحومة، واجعل تفرقنا من بعد تفرق معصومة، ولا تدع فينا ولا منا ولا بيننا الشقي ولا محرومة. اللهم اهدنا للهدى ووفقنا للتقوى وعافنا في الآخرة الأولى. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذريتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله. Thank you for coming. السلام عليكم.